Hey everybody, how's it? Aloha, this is Jeebs here, your old composer here at the Decomposer Lounge, pulling back the layers, dissecting your favorite tracks. And I am circling back to very suggested, constantly getting suggestions for Smashing Pumpkins. And I've done a couple already. So at the end of this video, I'll put up some other videos of other Smashing Pumpkin videos that I've done in the past. But this one actually comes from the album Siamese Dream. Now it says like it's a deluxe edition, so I don't know if that's the name of the album where the song that I'm doing, which is called Mayonnaise, is coming from, but apparently it's 1993, so some nice early Smashing Pumpkins here. So let's do this. Always looking forward to Smashing Pumpkins. His voice, his writing, just is so unique, and it's so cool, and it's so long-lasting. You know, it's legacy compositions, and that's what Smashing Pumpkins, I believe, is very well known for. And it's also very large in the soundtrack of life for millions and millions of people too. So that's always fun too. All right, guys, thank you so much. Like usual, thank you so much for the support. Ta-da! Let's do this. This is Smashing Pumpkins, 1993. The song is Mayonnaise from the deluxe edition Siamese Dream. Let's do this. All right. You know, this, you know, there's just such a uniqueness to his voice. It is such a, you know, I said the word earlier when we opened up the video, such a legacy sound. And it's so distinctive. But what I think is really unique, I'm gonna go a little ass backwards in this. I'm gonna start with his voice and the pocket that's being created by the engineer so that his voice in such a subtle performance against the power of the guitars and the track in of itself. It's such a craft, you know, and to for those of you who are the pure listeners, you're just here listening to the music and we're having a little fun, and you're not in the music industry or producer in engineering, it's the challenge is sculpting a space in the mixing. You've seen consoles, people with their faders and whatever. Well, it's not quite like that as much as it used to be. But the key is to craft a spot for the lead instrument, in this case it's vocals. And when you have something as delicate as a vocal performance as this against such powerful metal behind it, that is such an art form. you know, to get the punchiness of the guitars and everything, and then being able to get his voice in a place that it's still, you can understand the lyrics a little bit and you're feeling the melody and everything of that nature. So that's always a really, it's a challenge that these guys, obviously, it's just incredible how they did what they did. I love the opening of the guitars. The very clean sounds and the picking pattern, and also the lead work at the very beginning. You know, you saw me kind of go, oh, that's kind of cool how they were doing the pseudo harmonic, very tight poppy velocity that kind of almost rung out a little bit of a harmonic part of the strings and stuff, but it was very seductive and it got you in there and it was just kind of quiet and led you into it, so that by the time the punch of the guitars came and the distorted guitars came and you were really kind of lulled into this kind of kind of ethereal experience just by the way the cleanliness, the tone of the guitar, the cleanliness of the recording and everything like that. And also the chord changes too, which I'll get back to in a little bit. But I just wanted to stop really quick, kind of glow a little bit about Billy's voice and where it is and fitting in the pocket and stuff, you know, and being completely supported by this really super punchy guitar sound, and you know, the rock is in. Love that breakdown with the acoustic guitars. So clean. So sounds to me like it's doubled. You know, so played once, panned over hard left. Played another time, identical or close to, panned over hard right. But obviously you can hear there's slight playing variations that's happening there that complements each other. So they're doing the same chord changes. But at one point you saw me go like this, and they added a ninth or an extra or a note. This is a voicing in a guitar. So voicings and chords are very important. You can get so many dynamics out of playing the same chord, but it depends on where you play it on the guitar or piano, whatever. But in this case, what they did is they gave us this little sense of euphoria by adding a note, which is called a ninth in that particular, where I went, that was great. And what it does is that note addition to that chord kind of gave you this like, you know, and it's you know, actually the ninth is used pretty heavily in metal too, heavy metal, progressive metal and stuff like that. And it's a subtlety that really can add just an incredible lift or set you up for a really hard fall, depending how it's played. But I love that. Also, I didn't mention too, there was a little bit of a flange at the very first lead guitar, that very clean thing in the flange, is that swimminess that you hear. It sounded like a flange, it could be chorus, but in this case it sounded like a flange. And there was a really nice flange on the lead on this. And I haven't been glamming much on the bass with this because it's been pretty straightforward, but there's the bass player is doing some really fun turnaround arrangements, as you sometimes hear me talk about in these reactions, is how bass players have that same kind of relationship with drums when drummers will do a fill at the end of X amount of bars. You kind of feel it. Even if when you're the pure listener and you feel there's a change coming, it could always be emphasized, or some of the trigger mechanisms of that feeling would be, you know, if the drummer's ding, ding, ba, ding, 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 ba, you're okay. But now as soon as you hear ba, di, ba, ba, di, bu, da, di, ding, ding, ba, you know, so as the pure listener, you kind of feel that that change is going to come. And bass players have a wonderful propensity to work along those same lines too. It's just a key, whether you're reintroducing a measure or a change or something, is that come around. You know, kind of a thing. So, very nice warm bass tone on this too. So let me go back a little bit and we'll finish this off here. I love that, how they came into full circle with that by pulling us back into, you know, this kind of clean electric guitar sound that they opened up with, which is really, to me, that's a wonderful part of the production process when decisions like that are being made. How do we want to end this? What's the experience that we just took our listener through in the song? How do we want to end this? You know, hard stop, fades. In this case, this was still a fade, but they brought us back in to kind of in the full circle to close us up with the song and the journey. Something else too. I don't remember actually a particular melody in this that is repetitive in the sense of the hook. So what sings out for me more is the consistency and the fact that they really marinated in a series of chord changes that to me had a very impactful impact as a hook. So, you know, hooks traditionally have, and most people call that the chorus, it's that section that repeats itself, and it's that memory trigger, it's that pop culture song composition standard, if you would, you know, for at least the last 75 years, you know, of songwriting. And so we get used to listening for the, where's that hook, you know, in it to a minute to win it, if it was a radio, you know, if it's an A&R guy or somebody who's, you know, we got to get into the hook by a certain amount of time. And but to me, the overall hook is Billy's voice and his performance, you know. And I also, I love it, if I just kind of cycle back into some engineering for a second, the technique that they use on Billy's voice, I can only take a guess on what it is that is being used to engineer Billy's voice to give it that kind of width to the sound, whether it's a very, very light chorus or a very, very light doubling. And doubling in the 90s was done a little different than doubling is done now with plugins, I believe. But sometimes I would do doubling in vocals by using a really super millisecond delay and then kind of pull it wide, you know, to give it a very unique effect. So many different ways, and the engineers you know, of the 70s, 80s, and 90s had different techniques of doing things that are now, oh, I got a plug-in, I can hit that, and it's the Billy Corrigan setting, and all of a sudden it happens, or something of that nature. But in most cases, it's called a doubler. So anyhow, this was great. I really loved this. I love starting off my week this way. I've got some really fun things coming up this week, and I got my very first interview coming tomorrow. Could you imagine that? I'm doing my very first podcast, so that ought to be fun. Now, if you see this video 50 years from now, you can say, when did he do that podcast? So anyhow, that's my story. I'm sticking to it. If you're still here, you can type in, I'm still here. Thank you so much for hanging out. And yeah, got a great week planned for you ahead. For this week coming up ahead, planned for you. And getting me more coffee too, for God's sake. I started off with a half empty cup this morning because I had been up for a little bit. All right, guys, take care. Have a killer day. Aloha.